Good day, good people. And today we have seen Oz the Great and Powerful. Huzzah! I'll let you do it.
Hi.
Go on, do you want to give a synopsis? Because apparently mine is shit.
It was last week. Okay, Oz the Great and Powerful.
Huzzah!
It's the story of how the Wizard of Oz became the Wizard of Oz. And it's that in a nutshell.
That was shit.
No, it wasn't. That was straightforward. You can have the first review, because I hate going first.
Okay.
Ladies first.
It was okay. It was okay. That's the only sort of opinion I can really give of it, really, because, well, to start off, I know it's not the right thing to do, but I, in a way, kept comparing it to Alice in Wonderland because there's so many similarities in this.
Yeah.
Like, the art design is very much the same. And
it's almost set in the same world.
Yeah, exactly.
Oz and Wonderland are both very similar.
They're very similar, yeah. Because, I mean, I was saying it to you on the way home. At times, I could see that, I don't know how true it, I don't know if this is true or not, but I felt like they were planning this when they were making Alice. And because the art design's very much the same, and I felt like they were trying to, well, I reckon Disney thought, Alice is going to be a huge success, so we'll get Tim Burton to direct this as well, because, as I said, the art design's very similar, and they have the typical Tim Burton spirals, they even have the hill that's improbable in there, somehow, and
the because, graveyard scene.
Yeah, and the graveyard scene.
I didn't even know they had graveyards in Oz.
Yeah, exactly. Which was very Tim Burton. The fact they had Danny Elfman doing the music. So I felt that this was a very Tim Burton-ish film. So once Alice had flopped, they probably thought, shit, we better get someone else in. Who else can we get? Let's get that Sam Raimi guy, because Spider-Man did well. But it's a shame because, again, like Alice, there was aspects of this which were really nice. Like, the graveyard scene was fantastic. The mood in it and that was brilliant. The little China girl, she was great. But
was cute.
Yeah,
I liked her.
But everything else was just very meh. I mean, James Franco did an okay job as Oz. I mean, he served his purpose. Meg served her purpose as her character. Zach Braff was... Zach Braff for me, he was playing. I don't know, because I'm not that familiar with Zach Braff, so excuse.
Well, I am.
So excuse me for my ignorance here, but I felt he was playing his role very Billy Crystal-ish. Like if you would have took Zach Braff out and put Billy Crystal in, you wouldn't have noticed the difference.
I haven't. No, I don't know. Billy Crystal to me is a lot more cynical, a bit of a dick.
I don't know, they seemed very... They have similar voices as well.
Oh, yeah. Zach Braff was basically being Zach Braff. That's why the only thing I've ever really enjoyed him in is Scrubs, because he's the same character in fucking everything else. But I saw him first in Scrubs. Now, in Scrubs, it's good. Everything else he does is not so good. Which is a shame.
He's typecast.
He's a nice guy, but yeah, he's typecast a lot. And in this, you could tell it was him. I think that's the problem with this film is...
You could tell
you knew who everyone was.
Like,
I knew it was James Franco, aka Green Goblin.
Harry Osborn.
I knew it was Meg.
Meg!
I'm pretty sure Michelle Williams, who's Glinda, I'm pretty sure she's from X-Men, Mystique, the new version.
Right.
Because she looks just like her. I'm pretty sure that's her. And obviously, Zach Braff.
And you got Rachel Weisz.
Yeah, but she's...
Of the Mummy fame.
She's kind of...
Rachel Weisz.
Yeah. There was no one really that got into their characters.
No, they were just...
Without...
Except Bruce Campbell.
No,
once again,
you
Bruce...
know, you always know
him. No, but it's like John Ratzenberger.
Yeah,
he's there, and you love every second he's on screen. As I said to you on the way home, because Bruce Campbell has his part, which... Okay, yeah, it's fine. But I really wanted him to be a munchkin. How funny would that have been to have Bruce Campbell, the behemoth that he is.
With a huge chin.
With a huge chin as a munchkin.
But as I was saying...
You missed a beat there, Sam Raimi. You missed a beat.
The point is, I think, and they have the same problem with Alice in Wonderland, is too many celebrities. And when you get celebrities in, all you can see or hear is the celebrities. Like with Alice in Wonderland, you knew it was Johnny Depp. You knew it was Helena Bonham Carter. You knew it was fucking Stephen Fry. It's just really distracting.
Yeah.
I really think they could have done... I think the one aspect of Alice in Wonderland I did like was Alice. I know you didn't, but nobody knew who she was. It was a new Alice.
Yeah.
It was nice not to see, like, Reese Witherspoon playing her or something.
Yeah.
In this, you kind of knew every actor, and that was just really
distracting. You couldn't focus on their
character. Because they're not bad actors, but they're not...
They're not character actors.
They're not seasoned actors.
They're not character actors. A character actor, if people don't know, is the type... Think Gary Oldman. When you watch most films Gary Oldman's in, you forget it's Gary Oldman. You see the character. Like, perfect example is Sid and Nancy, the film about Sid Vicious. When you see that film, you... don't believe that's Gary Oldman because he's so good at playing Sid Vicious. So, point proven. But, as I said, this whole film was a bit meh for me. It was one of those films that had a lot of promise, but it wasn't executed very well. Which is a shame because I do enjoy Sam Raimi's work. And I'm very happy to hear that Sam Raimi is planning to write Evil Dead 4, which should be a good laugh riot. Oh yeah, and Ted Raimi's in it as well. So, every one of Sam Raimi's little cameos is in there. So... if you enjoyed Alice in Wonderland, you'll probably get something out of this because you enjoyed that. And it's, as we said, it's very similar. So you're going to get something for this. But for me, it was okay, but it was a bit of a disappointment for me. As I said, little bits that I liked, but it wasn't enough to save it.
I'm going to give it a couple of good points, simply because I went in not knowing what to expect. Well, in fact, until today, I had no idea what it was going to be like. And then you went, oh, it's going to be like Alice in Wonderland because the posters look like Alice in Wonderland. And then I was like, oh, shit. So you kind of spoiled that for me. But I still went in kind of with a clear mind. I didn't really know what I was going to get, except a lot. I knew there was going to be a lot of CGI, which there was. But,
it's like, hello, actors in front of a green screen.
You can kind of tell it was made to be in 3D just because everything's... jumps out of you, and there's always these swooping camera shots, and it's kind of trying to be like Avatar. The good points. Well, the thing with me and the Wizard of Oz, the whole story, I never read the books. I like the original film, the 1939 film with Judy Garland. I recently watched that again, not even in preparation for this, actually. I just felt like watching The Wizard of Oz last week, and then I watched Return to Oz as well, which is fucked up. So I have sort of a love-hate relationship with it. There's things about it that I really like, there's things about it that I don't like. It's the same with Alice in Wonderland. There's aspects of Alice in Wonderland, the story, that I like, and bits that I don't like. Get off your phone!
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm paying to watch this, but I'll be on my phone the whole time.
You've made me lose my place. All right.
I might just text my friend.
Shut
who's next
up!
To
I'm
me.
Talking. You've ruined it now. You ruined my speech.
Go on.
No.
Go on.
No, anyway, I forgot where I was.
You were talking about how you have a love hate.
Okay.
Feeling.
Yeah. So with Wizard of Oz, the main thing I've always hated about the Wizard of Oz is the wizard, because they have the whole thing is named after him. They have all this build up, and he's just an old fart, a coward who sends Dorothy out to kill the Wicked Witch, and he just sits up in his palace, does fuck all, and then gives him a bunch of crap presents at the end. And then he even has the gall to leave Dorothy behind as he floats off in his balloon that he has no idea how to use. And so she has to go back and find the Good Witch of the South or something, and then she gets home finally after learning about her magic shoes, which also pisses me off. How cruel is Glinda to make her go on this entire, like, death-filled journey just because she can't say, oh, your magic shoes can take you home anytime you want. Yeah, that really, really fucking annoys me. Glinda's a bitch.
It's because she's the cute witch of the
so
world.
So I've never been a fan of the wizard in The Wizard of Oz. I always thought he was a bit of a prick. And a completely throwaway character. I think the film should have been called, I think the whole sort of series should have just been called Dorothy. Or just Oz. Oz would have been good. But the credit I will give to this film is it kind of gives him a backstory. And it makes him kind of likeable, even if he is still a bit of a con man. He's selfish in that. He's got charisma. He's really kind of flamboyant. And he's a bit of a fun, you know, he's a bit of fun. I quite liked him. So in that sense, it's a good thing. It kind of makes me appreciate why there's all this build-up in the other films of, oh, the wizard is actually really cool. He saved Oz. Wahey. So in that sense, I kind of like it. I like the little China doll, as you said, just because she was cute. That's about it. I did like Mila Kunis. I think when she was playing Theodora as like just normal, as a human, then it was really obvious. It was just like, Meg.
Stop it, Meg.
So it was really, not to say that she isn't really, really attractive.
Well, when she's wearing tight leather pants and she happens to...
No.
She happens to bend over like this to the camera. Look at my ass.
I don't care. It's fan service. yeah.
I did some fan service. There's bound to be someone out there who likes my ass.
But I did like her as the Wicked Witch.
Spoiler!
How is that a spoiler?
I know it's not really a spoiler, but you have to say these things.
Okay, well, fair enough. We'll put spoiler in the title. I did think she was really... I think if you were going to this film not expecting to see the Wicked Witch, you'd be really pissed off.
Mm.
I did like her. I don't think like she's going to be like...
as iconic.
The iconic Wicked Witch or anything. But I thought she was fun. I thought she tried her best. She got really angry. And bless her. Even when you try and cover in ugly makeup, she's still pretty.
Let's give her a crook nose and a Bruce Campbell chin.
And a paint her green, but she's still Mila Kunis. She's still hot.
Aye, let's give her a big old cleavage.
I don't know. I enjoyed the film while I was watching it. I probably wouldn't watch it again. It doesn't really have multiple play factor. But I have seen worse, Alice in Wonderland. So that's my two cents. I think if you're bored and you're after an afternoon in the cinema, go see it. I actually think this would be better in 3D. Honestly, I think this would be one of those films that would actually be fun in 3D if you wanted to pay the extra money.
And get two shots. And get two shots.
No, there were way more. There were way more. Don't be challenging me, son.
I could be like this for ass.
Okay, can we wrap it up now?
Yes. Final thoughts?
It wasn't a bad film. It just wasn't.
For me, it was
different. I did like the opening credits, actually. Yeah, they were really cool. In fact, from the opening credits, I thought, wow, I'm going to love this. I didn't love it, but I did like the opening
credits. And the disappointment started then.
I was just like, oh, I love these credits. They were really fun. And very Tim Burton-y.
Yeah, I have to agree with that one, actually, yes. But then the disappointment came in and... yeah. And... I'm probably not going to do a spoiler as well, but you get the whole black and white into colour as well. Shock.
I like that, actually. I know it was just an homage to the old Wizard of Oz.
Hmm.
But I knew they were... I kind of figured out, like, right from the start that was what they were going to do.
Yeah.
It's pretty obvious.
Yeah.
But I like that. I even like the fact that it went from old-fashioned...
4:3 to 16:9.
To widescreen.
Yeah. Like in the Simpsons movie.
Did it?
Yes, it did. So Simpsons got that first.
Okay, come on.
Yeah, disappointing. But there's one particular scene. I'm not going to say which scene. It's towards the end of the film. And he's giving gifts. And there's a particular gift that he gives. And for this gift, just picture him saying, "It's my penis." And the next scene that follows will be turned on its head for you. I'm Kent Brockman. Good night.
Fuck off. I'm a ghost.